Cantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents The Complex PTSD Coping Skills Workbook, an evidence-based approach to manage fear and anger, build confidence, and reclaim your identity. By Tamara McClintock Greenberg, PsyD. Narrated by Hana Lass. Publisher's note. In this audio edition, you will hear references to figures present in the print and ebook formats of the book. Limit of liability, disclaimer of warranty. This publication is designed to provide accurate and authoritative information in regard to the subject matter covered. It is sold with the understanding that the publisher is not engaged in rendering psychological, financial, legal, or other professional services. If expert assistance or counseling is needed, the services of a competent professional should be sought. Introduction. If you've selected this book, I'll guess you've experienced some difficult things in your life, and that you are also incredibly resilient. This is common in trauma survivors, and one reason we as a culture often focus on the concept of surviving, not victimhood. Complex post-traumatic stress disorder, or CPTSD, occurs when you have experienced what's known as complex trauma. This is trauma that's caused not by one discrete traumatic event, but by multiple events, usually beginning in childhood, that have profound impacts on your self-concept and your ways of relating to others. CPTSD happens based on the aggregate of trauma. It represents what is often a life filled with difficulties. As such, the symptoms of CPTSD can be more severe, long-lasting, and woven into your personality, which is different than what happens with post-traumatic stress disorder, PTSD. As you'll hear me describe, CPTSD has a profound impact on identity. Early and repeated traumas take away important aspects of our sense of self. Ultimately, they result in a kind of identity theft. They can cause us to be unclear about our true thoughts and feelings, and can make us unsure of the kinds of people we want or need to be around. It makes it hard to know how to be assertive. It makes it hard to know how we can take care of ourselves. Who you really are can be confusing, especially if your history is murky and unclear, with limited or disjointed narratives. And when you're in this situation, anger, fear, and uncertainty can become a powerful presence in your life and in ways that are often unwelcome. This book aims to help you understand your complex trauma and the way it has impacted your entire life and your identity. I'm honored that you are here, and I hope that I can provide tools and ideas to reclaim aspects of your life that may have been stolen because of what you have had to endure. Complex trauma involves multiple betrayals, including overt abuse, neglect, and having to experience difficult circumstances way before you should have to. It also involves traumas experienced as an adult. These experiences can make it tough to know how to take care of yourself. I will help you with the first part of the standard treatment for CPTSD, which is understanding the neurobiology of trauma, what's commonly known as the fight-flight-freeze response, so you can create a basic sense of safety for yourself in your life, learning healthier coping skills for intrusive experiences of fear, anger, and anxiety, building the basics of metacognition, or your ability to think about your own thinking, and building social support to help you deal with your CPTSD. We'll also talk about some of the more challenging aspects of CPTSD symptoms, like substance abuse and suicidal thoughts, and learn coping mechanisms for those painful and frightening experiences, as well as some ideas of when it might be good to ask for help. The second part of treatment, dealing with the memories of your traumatic experience through cognitive behavioral therapy, exposure therapy, EMDR, psychodynamic therapy, and other techniques, is something a professional can help you with, because it is beyond the scope of this workbook. It's also true that you may not need or want to take this step. Ultimately, it depends on your experience of CPTSD and what you feel you need once the symptoms of CPTSD that most affect your day-to-day life and your core sense of self have been addressed. That said, an entire chapter in this book is devoted to thinking about how to find a therapist, using research that explains, to the best of our knowledge, how healing in therapy works and what kinds of therapists and treatments may be right for you. How to use this book. The really great thing about a workbook is you can use parts of it or all of it in large chunks or small doses. Take on aspects of this book as it feels right for you. You can use the book alone or with someone you trust, like a therapist. Do keep in mind that not all aspects of the book may be ones you can relate to. Keep your individual journey in mind as you listen. Also consider that though some of the skills and ideas in this book may seem simple to absorb, often, true change means revisiting some of the same ideas in different moods and states of mind. So, patience and persistence are key. There are also some additional materials at the website for this book, like worksheets and a bonus chapter to educate loved ones about CPTSD symptoms. newharbinger.com/49708. That's newharbinger.com/49708. Finally, keep in mind that since this is a book about trauma, there are times when I will discuss material, in composite form, not related to any one person, related to some of the more difficult things people with CPTSD have experienced. I want you to know that it's always a mixed thing to provide case examples in a book like this, and I do so with as little detail as possible while still speaking to you, and to also indicate that I can empathize as best as I can with the kinds of trauma that you may have been subjected to. I do describe emotional, physical, and sexual abuse, as well as neglect, again, in as vague detail as possible, but it's there. It can be intense and a lot to hear. And if it's too much, please feel free to do what you might in a scary movie. Hit fast forward and skip to the coping skills. However, if the material is consistently triggering or painful, I encourage you to note what you're reacting to and discuss it with your therapist or clinician. A note on the COVID-19 pandemic. I wrote a large part of this book during 2020, one of the more challenging years of my life, and I'm guessing yours too. None of us could have predicted that a global pandemic would upend everything we once took for granted. The disruptions were endless, but included limits to our personal freedom, our ability to seek and give comfort in the usual ways. We lost closeness in aspects that are obvious, like not being able to have our loved ones over for dinner and not being able to visit elders in care facilities. But we lost personal connections in small ways, too. We missed chatting with colleagues in our offices, gossiping with neighbors, and even the banters with taxi and rideshare drivers. Suddenly, we could not exercise like we did, go to a movie, or eat food in public places without fear. We became more alone, though social media persisted and for some became a main source of contact with the external world. However, social media is a very mixed thing. On the one hand, it reminded us there were others going through what we were. On the other, our internet communities seemed to silently shame us if we were rightfully sad and scared about the unbelievable numbers of deaths instead of harnessing our sourdough bread baking skills or learning a new instrument or new language. The pandemic challenged self-concepts for everyone, but even more so for survivors of trauma who may have a shaky or limited sense of self to begin with. Yet, I noticed something remarkable among many of my clients with CPTSD. Locked down with fewer distractions, many people took the opportunity to try to understand themselves, their lives, and their relationships better. Of course, this was not simply because of opportunity. The lack of diversions led to increases in symptoms among many people. Flashbacks, nightmares, increases in fear and anger related to the present and the past. All of this fails to mention how strained some relationships became. Some people questioned their partnerships, while people who were single felt isolated and ignored. And yet, with all the loss and all the uncertainty, many people found ways to grow and change and cope. And I'm not talking about mastering baking skills, though if you did, that's great too. My point is this: no matter how hard things get, people find ways to be resilient. And even if it was only managing and barely making it through, that's good enough. I don't mention the pandemic in the rest of this book. I want to imagine a world when the pandemic or other such moments of society-wide crisis won't be a burden on you. That this will hopefully be something in your rearview mirror, something that has been left mostly behind. I understand that scars from the pandemic or other disasters we might have experienced will remain for all of us. For trauma survivors, they'll be woven into already existent trauma narratives, even ones that are disjointed. Whether or not we lost someone close to us, it will take years to not only understand and digest, but to grieve all that we have lost. But resilience is a quality you can cultivate in yourself to make even times of great adversity more bearable, and to strengthen and maintain your sense of identity and self-worth no matter what life may bring. Setting out on your unique journey. Like survivors themselves, the experience of trauma is incredibly diverse. However, I do hope that many aspects of this book speak to you, help you feel understood, seen, and less alone, and that through the work we will do together, you will find your voice and reclaim your identity from the trauma that tried to take it away. Chapter 1. Complex PTSD versus PTSD. Julie is a woman in her late 20s. She is bright, charming, and incredibly thoughtful and perceptive. She chose a nursing career that allows her to help others. Her intuitive instincts about what people need have served her well. Although this aspect of her life is successful, her past haunts her. She grew up with disinterested parents, who often left her alone for extended periods of time when she was far too young. At other times, she was left in the hands of caretakers who did not have her best interests in mind. As a young adult, she experienced a number of difficult stressors, one involving a natural disaster that destroyed her home. There were also other incidents of relational betrayals, including difficulties with romantic partners that did not respect her boundaries. Although Julie has been incredibly resilient, she struggles with intrusive memories of things she would rather not think of. Though she tries to maintain a cheerful attitude toward life, at times she feels underwater with intense feelings of anxiety and depression. Sometimes she can even wonder if life should be as hard as it is. Though she has had many friends and acquaintances, she finds that people can be incredibly disappointing, yet she wonders if this is due to bad luck or if something is amiss in terms of whom she picks. Julie's thoughtfulness can also lead her to feel overly responsible for things that may not be her fault. And at times, she worries her emotions can become too big and her expression of emotions too outsized for some situations. She spends a lot of time confused about how best to respond to situations in which she feels something is unfair, and it's never quite clear, in her own mind, if she has taken a needed stance or overreacted. If you recognize aspects of Julie in yourself, you are not alone. What I have presented so far about Julie are just a few things that affect people impacted by complex post-traumatic stress disorder, or CPTSD. You're probably familiar with post-traumatic stress disorder, PTSD. You may also have been hearing a lot more lately about CPTSD. In this chapter, we'll explore what CPTSD is and how it's distinct from PTSD. A lot of people who have CPTSD symptoms can seem hard to understand using the older and mostly male-dominated norms in my field. As a therapist and a woman who has lived through trauma, this has been painful for me. It can be difficult for any of us with histories of trauma to know how to express ourselves, how to protect ourselves, and how to get what we really need. One major purpose of this book is to say that things are changing in the psychology world. The increase in interest in CPTSD is evidence of that, and your struggles are seen, they are common, and they can be understood. Moreover, even though your challenges have been hard, there is a path to feeling and being more in control of your life, even to reclaim the parts of life that have been taken from you. In this chapter, you'll begin your journey to recovery from complex trauma by understanding what CPTSD is and the consequences it can have for you, as well as how you understand yourself, your own feelings, thoughts, and mind, which is the first step to changing responses to trauma, related patterns, and the effects they may be having on your life. What is CPTSD? Classic, or traditional PTSD, happens when we experience one or two discrete traumatic events, or events that cause more psychological stress than you have tools to cope with. Complex trauma, on the other hand, involves the aggregate of traumatic events that have accrued over a lifetime. Many people with complex PTSD have experienced abusive or adverse experiences in childhood. Abusive experiences include the obvious things we consider when we think of abuse, such as physical harm and sexual abuse. It also includes emotional manipulation that involves caregivers exploiting their power, or what some people refer to as betrayal trauma. This is when someone we trust, someone we need, acts in ways that are harmful to us, even when they know better. An example might be a parent whose discipline is designed to humiliate us and/or to grant them pleasure from our suffering. Other difficult or adverse childhood experiences that can cause CPTSD include severe neglect, a household member who has been incarcerated, substance abuse in the home, a caretaker who was suicidal, and/or domestic violence. Those with CPTSD often have repeated experiences of violence, trauma, or other extremely taxing events that start in childhood and which often continue into adulthood. This latter issue has been studied in a variety of ways, but the shorthand way of expressing it is to say that if you have a traumatic history, you may be more likely to be victimized later in life. Complex trauma has been minimized and not well understood. For many years, people who have experienced complex trauma were often told they had personality disorders, especially borderline personality disorder, or BPD. This is problematic for several reasons. People who have survived complex trauma can feel that a personality disorder diagnosis doesn't fit because it implies that what are actually symptoms in response to trauma are simply products of your personality, which in turn makes it hard to get better. Also, labeling CPTSD as a personality disorder carries a stigma that negates how incredibly resilient trauma survivors are. Your coping mechanisms and the ways you cope with stress are often a product of the environment, not something that is inherently wrong with you. Healing is about internal reflection, as well as noticing patterns of a familiarity in being around people who may not always have your best interest in mind. To put a finer point on this, let's reflect on a realization from a client who has spent considerable amounts of time thinking about their life and their troubles, who told me, "I know I have a part in my problems, and maybe I do things that push people's buttons sometimes, but I realized that my issues are not just me, it's the people I surround myself with. I have people in my life who gaslight me or even don't treat me that well, and now I'm like, wait. I have to deal with both myself and also what I allow myself to put up with." In other words, they'd suddenly realized that people in their life were mistreating them. People who have survived complex trauma can and do get better, but it starts with realistic and accurate diagnoses and a movement away from pathologizing. That work is happening, if slowly. Although the CPTSD diagnosis is not in the most recent edition of the psychiatric Bible known as the Diagnostic and Statistical Manual of Mental Disorders, or DSM-5, it is included in the newest version of the International Classification of Diseases, or ICD-11, which is published through the World Health Organization. Recently, many psychologists, doctors, and other mental health professionals have been willing to increase their understanding of the lifelong impact trauma has. But in the years preceding this shift, we let clients down. Perhaps you've had the experience of a mental health professional who couldn't recognize the trauma you experienced. This often happens when the trauma wasn't the result of one or two discrete traumatic experiences, but instead relational in nature, based on attachments you have or have had. These are often related to long-term relationships you had, as a child or an adult, which shaped the way you connected to others, including yourself, for years to come. But this is also where you can be optimistic. Relationships can hurt, but they also can heal. This workbook can be the start of that healing. It can help you deal with the complex trauma you experienced and the anxiety, fear, and anger you might be feeling, and start you on the road to finding true support by cultivating stronger relationships with others and with yourself. CPTSD as identity theft. At its core, complex trauma involves our identities. When we are young, we need a safe environment. This sounds obvious. It's not good if we don't feel cared for. But the result of trauma and other difficult experiences is that we become too distracted to develop a relationship with our own minds. What I mean by this is that adults who have not been repeatedly traumatized experience the world very differently than those who have. Typically, someone without CPTSD knows what they want and can make decisions about what their adult lives should look like. It may be easier for them to get along well with a variety of different people. They don't worry as much about what's on others' minds. They can enter relationships without much fear. They also typically know when relationships are not helpful. They can sense when something is not right, and even when it's hard, they can leave, as painful as it may be. Ultimately, the difference between those who haven't experienced complex trauma and those who have is the level of confidence in knowing what we think and how we feel. If we can think about ourselves clearly, we can take the actions we need to take care of ourselves. But trauma takes away the ability to trust your own instincts. This is just one way trauma robs us of aspects of our identity. Considering trauma that starts in childhood, the job of being a kid should involve us learning how to handle emotions of all kinds and how to distinguish what is on our minds versus what others might be thinking or feeling. When the environment is not safe, we can get distracted in a few fundamental ways. There are many ways the cycle of trauma can impact your sense of self, and these are explored in Figure 1.1, which can be found in the print and ebook versions of this book. As you consider the information in this section, assess which may apply to you. Your identity and your sense of self are profoundly impacted by all the elements that surround it, as shown in Figure 1.1. Here, an unsafe early environment and additional traumatic events you might experience as an adult can lead to fear, which can lead to hypervigilance, a super sharp focus on what's going on around you and the threats that we feel may be present. Because of both the nature of traumatic events and the burden of CPTSD symptoms, anger is another common and understandable result. The weight of fear and anger are often linked with intense feelings of anxiety, which can lead to dissociation, a kind of collapse or fracture of the mind that makes it hard for us to feel our sense of self as coherent, which can trigger or worsen the entire trauma cycle. Ultimately, both early trauma and repeated experiences of mistreatment make us afraid in ways that never really go away until we deal with them. Fear manifests itself in many ways. Sometimes, fear can land more in the body, often through physical illnesses that can be exacerbated by the physiological effects of chronic stress and bodily hyperactivation. But it is also experienced in the mind through anxiety, anxious rumination, and the intense anxiety felt during panic attacks. Sometimes we work to mask the fear we feel with hypervigilance, the tendency to focus on the external to keep track of everything going on in our environment. Anxiety can even be linked to dissociation, the tendency to leave one's mind during stressful events. Dissociation can be particularly scary. We'll discuss it in detail in upcoming chapters. The fear we feel when we experience complex trauma can guide us to various kinds of coping mechanisms in childhood and adulthood. Some people who have repeated adverse childhood and adult experiences can get very focused on what other people are thinking and feeling. There are some benefits to this way of coping. It can be helpful for us to understand others, and this is the true root of empathy. It can also make for a great career. Think of how helpful doctors, nurses, lawyers, and therapists are if they really try to understand the minds of the people they are trying to help. or even an amazing hairstylist whom you can't wait to gab with because you know they will understand. However, if you're struggling with complex trauma, you may do this for others a bit too much. You may spend so much time thinking about what's on others' minds that you don't really know what's on your own. This is a way trauma commits identity theft. If you become solely focused on what others want from you, trauma can rob you of the chance to become the kind of person you might have been. And when you're frustrated or disappointed, you may check out even more, which can leave you ill-prepared to take care of yourself if things go awry in relationships. These things can lead us to have difficulty with the development of a strong and cohesive identity. To state it plainly, trauma makes us too preoccupied with others or the fear we feel to think about who we are and who we want to become. Understanding your trauma symptoms. The following exercise will help you assess your CPTSD symptoms as well as the impact CPTSD may be having on your identity, your ability to know yourself. Write down if you have any of the following experiences: feelings of shame or guilt, a sense of meaninglessness, difficulty managing intense emotions, frequent suicidal thoughts and feelings, a feeling of being numb and disconnected from others, a sense of being overactivated and unable to calm down, periods of losing attention and concentration and spacing out, amnesia or loss of memories of events, physical symptoms such as headaches, dizziness, chest pains, and stomach aches, more substance use than you think is common, or using substances to become numb, thoughts, memories, or images you try to not think about, a pattern of relationships where you're mistreated but have trouble leaving, exaggerated startle response, for example, jumping if someone comes up behind you, taking more risks than seems normal for you, feedback on your own experience that you might be too angry, irritable, or defensive, mistrust in relationships, even when it's not clear you should be suspicious, overly trusting people who you know on some level may be dangerous, an idea that you have had a number of bad things happen to you, which you may or may not remember in detail, specific memories or flashbacks of traumatic events that you don't want to think about, experiencing yourself as uniquely damaged or toxic, a sense of not being real or not feeling like a human being, a sense of numbing and confusion that may lead to self-harm, self-injury, eating disorders, unexpected thoughts or memories of things you would rather not think about, nightmares, anger blackouts, getting really angry or blowing up and not remembering it, difficulty knowing something that happened really happened versus a worry that you made it up, a number of intense fears that seem excessive to you, for example, worries about taking public transportation, a fear of being trapped, panic regarding going to the doctor or dentist, etc. Chronic or severe anxiety. Feeling like a failure or feelings of being worthless. Difficulty choosing a career. Problems working with others or in groups. A general sense that life has no meaning. The more experiences you have from this list, the more likely it is you may experience CPTSD symptoms. Of course, it's always helpful to check with a professional if you would like a formal diagnosis. Either way, this checklist is designed to get you thinking about the symptoms of CPTSD and how this may impact your life. Assessing your experiences. As you may have noticed, complex PTSD involves symptoms of what we think of as traditional PTSD symptoms, as well as things that might be woven into our personalities. Sometimes we may or may not be fully aware of these things. For example, anxiety and/or anger are often manifestations of fear, or sometimes feelings we experience, but we may not even be aware of how anxious or angry we seem until we hear about it from others or have a therapist suggest it. You may not be aware that there's fear at the heart of that anxiety or anger, and that trauma you've experienced in the past plays a role in that fear. Consider a client of mine, Jane. She's gotten feedback at work that she is not a team player. She herself has noticed that she tends to, in her words, blow up relationships very quickly when she's frustrated. But just as often, in fraught interpersonal situations, she spaces out, and there are certain interactions in the past she truly can't remember. For the longest time, Jane just thought of herself as difficult or moody. It wasn't until we identified some of her past experiences as traumatic that she realized that before the events that would upset her, she was always nervous about something. It may be jarring to learn that we can be anxious or afraid and not really know it, but it happens more than you might think. I have a colleague who literally jumps when people say her name or someone comes up behind her. She's not even aware of being afraid, but she looks terrified. Her heart rate seems to speed up as she will breathe more rapidly, and sometimes she starts sweating. She is not aware of emotional anxiety at all. It's just a part of who she is and how she functions. This brings us back to the difference between PTSD and complex PTSD. People with PTSD have had a traumatic event happen to them, and they often remember it even if they are deeply troubled by it. When they act the way my colleague acts, they can likely link the behaviors, referred to as hypervigilance and an exaggerated startle response, as being related to a specific traumatic event. But people with C-PTSD may not have this awareness. Since C-PTSD impacts your identity, one impact may be that you don't recognize yourself as a traumatized person. You may consider yourself difficult, moody, or troubled. You may blame yourself for your problems, even if only privately and deep down. With such a negative opinion of yourself, you may find it difficult to understand your own thoughts, feelings, and needs. More difficult than it would be if you understood yourself as a traumatized person who has been conditioned to act in certain ways. As such, some people may have less awareness of their problems and the understanding that they come by these symptoms honestly, as attempts to deal with what started as external insults and threats. People with CPTSD also sometimes have trouble knowing and understanding what is meaningful. They're often good at figuring out what others want, but this knowledge comes at the expense of not knowing what they themselves may need. Therefore, it may be hard to identify your own values and goals. What's more, even if you do know your goals and achieve them, you might not know if you're happy as a result. I have worked with dozens of professionals with CPTSD. Many have told me they aren't sure why they pursued the career that they did. In some cases, it seemed like a good way out of poverty. Others thought a prestigious career would make them happy, or maybe had people in their lives push them toward prestige. Whatever the case, they were deeply unhappy and felt that they did not own their lives. This is another example of how identity theft can impact people with trauma histories. Things may appear good on the outside, but internal worlds can be marked with confusion and feelings of being lost that keep you from being able to recognize what in your life is good, or keep you from feeling that what you've achieved is truly what you wanted. One caveat to what I have described so far. People have a variety of symptoms for many different reasons, and not everything can be linked to trauma. When you have CPTSD, you may know on some level that things have happened to you, but what some of those things are may be fuzzy and unclear. On the other hand, you may very well know certain details of things that constituted traumatic events. Ultimately, the goal of this book is not to tell you what happened to you. It's not necessary to plumb your trauma to the depths to deal with CPTSD symptoms, or to relate every difficulty you experience.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.